this right here will be my next Ilg fan repair project. As you can see, this one is quite in bad shape. If despair was a fan, this fan would be despair. Even had to draw a little face on it showing just how unhappy it is right now. And you might not be able to see from this angle, but the frame of the fan is actually bent. This is bent down. And even though the fan is sitting on blocks on that side, the blades rub the ground here, and they're not supposed to go beyond the shroud. So this one is really in bad shape. Right here, that's where there was a fire. There was one of those plastic cigarette disposal things, like a smoker's outpost, sitting here on it. And that caught on fire and burned. So this thing's been dropped, it's been on fire. It's had a rough life, but at least it's not on a scrap train to China. So I guess things could be worse. And I'm gonna start on this build. I'm not sure exactly when. I'm just gonna try to get it on a stand out of the way where I can be mobile. And then I have some other things that have come up. They're gonna take my time. That tip of that wing is broken on the blade set. And I've ordered some new type of brazing compound that should be able to braze that without cutting it off and exposing completely fresh aluminum. Because I still have the piece and it fits on there perfectly. So if I don't have to cut anything off, I'm not going to affect the balance nearly like I would if I had to grind all that and make it a newly exposed material. And that should arrive next week, so time will tell if I get around to that. And the missing wing I've got over there, there's nothing wrong with that one. On to starting to tear it down. Okay, the first order of business is going to be to get the blade off. And from the looks of that, it is rusted. And that key is still there with the head on it, but I remember from my 48-inch build, that head just shears right off. So I'm sure this is gonna require the puller bolt holes to be drilled. And rather than wasting time, I'm gonna go ahead and get on that and try to get this pulled off. Well, as expected, that sheared right off, didn't move the key out, so it's gonna be puller time. That right there is what you call a very, very formerly stuck hub. I had to heat that with the torch and run that puller all the way down to the very last. And man, that is brutal. On the fan I just got through with, this nozzle provided enough heat to get the hub off. Not on this one, I had to change to this size. And that still barely did it. Now you may notice some grinding marks on the end of that. That is where I had to use this tool and go in between the joint between the shaft and the hub. The reason for that, some genius in the past had tried to use a sledgehammer to drive the shaft out of the fan hub and flared the shaft out. And that was especially bad because there was a chamfer on the hub and it flared out and filled in that chamfer just like expanding a rivet head. So there was no way for me to press that that shaft through the hub with it flared out on the end. And the only way I could get that corrected was to cut in there with the grinder. Now this shaft was actually too long. The fan blade didn't sit down here against this shoulder, so I needed to remove some shaft anyway, so it's no big deal that I messed up the end of that. And there's the other half of the grinder mark area that where I had to go in between the chamfer. This had a chamfer in it and the shaft, and cut out the mushroomed end of the shaft. And like I said, that's some hammer and chisel mechanic worked on it in the past to cause that damage. When it goes back together, you'll never see it because that piece will be on there. Well, I'm trying to straighten this frame, and what I've got here is a hydraulic jack, and the primary support is this piece of half inch by, I guess, three steel flat bar on edge. And then these 2x4s here just to help keep everything from flipping sideways. But that steel strip is going to bear the force. And this little piece of wood here is just a measurement point, like a straight edge. And I show you just how bad off this is. Measuring from the shroud to the top of that 2x4, looks like about 10 3/4 from that side. I come over here, 12 inches plus. So you can see what's going to have to happen. And I'm going to try to use that jack to push up the frame and straighten. Because right in here is bent, right in here is bent. And these are twisted right here, but I think that twist is just an elastic twist. And as soon as this pipe is straightened out, those will go back to normal. Well, here goes nothing. Now, when you're dealing with hydraulic force, it can get real in a hurry. So maybe you get to see some stuff fly, but I hope not. It feels like something's happening. Take a measurement. That's 11.5. That is almost 11. So let me take the pressure off and see how much it recoils. Well, I had to continue a little more adjusting with the jack. You can see that pulled out. I'll have to re-weld that. That's no big deal. And on this side, from the shroud to the top of that wood, about 12 1/4. And over here on this side, right about 12, so I'm within 1/4 inch. So what I can do is just push down on it by hand a little bit when I weld that seam in, and it should be just right. Well, that's taken care of. And now I've got, looks like about 12 1/8 on that end. And I go down to this end, and I've got maybe 12 1/16. So within 1/8 or 1/16, I call that good enough. I mean, the dimension of this fan, that little bit of difference isn't going to matter. Well, I got this little cover plate made there. Made a cardboard pattern, took it and clamped it onto this old piece of a pressure washer belt guard. Just used some of these little clips to hold it. Then just simply cut it out with the plasma torch around that. And when I put it up here, marked it from the inside and folded this lip over to give it some kind of a finished look. And that'll take care of that. One more step out of the way. All right, got a little bit of motor work going on here. Have the rotor cleaned up and ready. Bearing is, I've took this bearing apart and cleaned it out. And made a new crimped in copper ring to hold the seal back in. That's the original bearing. New departure brand, made in USA. Stator, I put some fresh varnish on there. I've got this hooked up to a battery charger. Putting some DC current through it to warm it up. It's been warm for about 2 or 3 hours. Even got a wrench in here testing the magnetic field. Turn off the charger. Yep, magnetism was working. So, gonna start setting this together. The rear bearing, I didn't try to put the seal back in. I just didn't see any need. It goes into a blind pocket on the rear housing, and I can just pack that with grease and not have to worry about the rear seal. It's still got the front seal in there good. So the front bearing, since that there could be some debris that comes in around the shaft, I did reinstall the seal. There's one little dented area where I had to pry it out, unlike modern bearings, somehow they flared this inside a groove in the bearing. I don't know how they manufactured it, but I bet that was some expensive bearing back in the day. Still perfectly smooth. Get ready to set this thing together. Compared to the older motors that had the grease cups, this one had the seal bearings and therefore no grease cups. So no grease had gotten outside the bearing and into this pocket. And as a result, it was rusted and very difficult to disassemble. I had to fabricate some pullers and whatnot. So I put grease in there to, even though the bearing is sealed and already packed with grease, I put that grease in there to help protect the bearing bore in the housing and just keep rust at bay. Another thing, got that fixed. Cut off about 3/4 of an inch of shaft and then made it flush and put the threaded hole in it. And that should go back together easily. Okay, rotor and front housing are together. Spin smoothly. Not 1000% quiet, but definitely very serviceable. And the rear bearing is also good. Now, time for this to go on there. And through the magic of YouTube, that thing just jumped on there in an instant. Now, time for the rear cover. Now, like I said, I'm not putting the seal back on that bearing because it's very difficult to put those back on. And there's no need for it because this is a sealed compartment anyway. And I put a little bit extra grease to give it some extra grease in case some of it pushes out of the ball bearing area. But being a low-speed motor, I really don't think it'll be a problem. There's a lot of bearings that are designed this way with a one-sided seal go into a closed chamber. So get that put on and maybe make a test run of the motor. Well, got the motor all hooked up for a test run here. Got the VFD on it. And I'm going to bring it up a little bit here slowly. Unfortunately, I guess I got dirt in those bearings or I didn't clean them as well as I thought. They felt smooth when I turned them by hand, but after I ran the motor, they've got debris in them. So I'll have to change them. Here's some grittiness in there. It's 42 hertz. There's 60 right there. That's the frequency, voltage, and current. See the rotor in there turning? Well, I'm going to run it up to 120 hertz, two times the normal speed. Running at 200% speed is perfectly balanced. There's the frequency right there. Now time for at least one time we're going to give it all it's got. Put my hand right on the motor. No vibration. Four times its design speed. I'll ramp it back down to 60. its normal running speed. Next video may be a couple days, but hopefully I'll be brazing the fan blade back together. Now, for those of you who are curious, what I've got here is a 3 kVA transformer. It's stepping 120 volt power up to 460 or 480. And then I have the VFD, which is creating the three-phase power, and it changes the voltage and the frequency to what the motor needs. The settings are programmed in it to keep the volts per hertz ratio for the motor. And I just plug this into 120 volt, and then I've got an analog system here, a little potentiometer, and this is a 10 volt DC supply, and that's the signal. And just the higher the voltage on that signal, the faster the motor runs. 0 volts on that center pin is stop, and 10 volts is 100% power. And you program the 100% is in here. Right now I have it set for 240 hertz, which is the maximum for this drive. For the fan, like, I use the same system on my 48 inch Ilg fan, and I program that the maximum is 65 hertz. So when the throttle handle is at maximum, it's 65 hertz. Very, very simple to configure. So big transformer, drive, and the motor work together. Very efficient like this. The amps drawn from the line cord through the transformer and the drive. Because the reactive power is only circulated between the motor and the drive electronically, you're only taking in real power with the almost perfect power factor. And that's a really good thing about this. Especially with these big old motors that have a really bad power factor, this takes care of that. The 48 inch has been running all day today. And remembering back to the VFD I just showed you, this lever, the speed control lever, controls that 0 to 10 volt signal. You can hear it ramping up now. Move it down, it was back to a slower speed. This is just a potentiometer.